You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's Scandal After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Scandal After Show.
Hello, Gladiators. We are here doing another AfterBuzz TV after show for Scandal, Season 3, Episode 10, A Door Marked Exit. I'm your host today, Sofia Stanley, along with my fellow Gladiators. They can introduce themselves.
Hey, what's up, everybody? I'm Kennelia.
And I'm Bamm Ericsen.
And Emil cannot be with us, but he will be around during the holidays, so make sure to hit him up on social media, on Twitter, as well as Facebook. Well, we're going to kick the door down and get right into this episode, and we are going to start right with Sally Langston killing her husband. God, please be with me. What do you guys think?
She stabbed him so hard. Even Bamm, when we were watching after we were done, Bamm was like, did she hit him first? Because she stabbed him so hard that you can hear the force going into his back. Sally, that was the best biblical talk I have heard in a long time. And I'm talking about since being in the church back in the day. Sally was going with that biblical talk. She like, it was like scripture after scripture, like quote after quote. She said, one of the quotes she said to Daniel, "You have unleashed a snake into our garden." What, Sally? Mm. Oh, I can't.
Bamm, you seem not to agree in a certain way.
Sally, my problem with Sally's character is she's a Bible thumper. She's always throwing rocks and wants to hide her hand. But again, the husband called her out. You knew it. You saw me with that guy back in, I think, when we were in college. And so she asked for this.
But okay, I'm going to play devil's advocate, pun intended. Arguably, regardless of whether or not she knew that he had certain sexual desires for other people, regardless of their sex, if in fact they had a deal, i.e. a marriage, to stay committed to one another, regardless then of whom you may be attracted to, regardless of what sex they may be, you should honor your marriage, number one. Number mm-hmm. two, she specifically said to him prior to him sleeping with James, "Hey, I'm about to make a bid for the presidency. All of our hard work is going to be realized. I need you in this period to stay strong and steadfast, i.e. don't screw anybody, especially a dude."
I get that. I understand that. But what I'm saying is he did what he did. There was obviously problems in the relationship because Daniel has not popped up anywhere until season three. So they were estranged. You never seen him around from season one to season two. They were estranged. Something was clearly going on. And so what I say, when I mean that Sally asked for this in the sense of when you're throwing darts back and forth, you know, you can throw all these scriptures and all these things at him. But the reality is you have dirt that you're doing too, Sally. So it's like, I feel like the conversation could have totally went better, but because she didn't like what was being said at her, she took her frustration out on him and she killed him. You can tell by the way that she was stabbing him. She was angry. She was taking her frustration out on her. And you know, Sally's been this whole ticking time bomb. It's been a buildup. And you know, in the end, he's dead. She's alive. She killed him. But all that Bible talk, Sally, you're the one that's going to hell. Quote unquote.
She told Cyrus, when he came to help her, when she was hallucinating or, you know, in the zone or whatever. She said how bad she thought she was and what was going to happen, yada, yada, yada.
But, and that she needed justice and yeah. She needs to tell.
But the type of woman that Sally is, she thinks that Daniel's actions are a choice. A lot of Bible thumpers don't. They think that, you know, you wake up one day and you're like, you know what, I'm going to be gay today. So she came at him from the standpoint when she first talked to him and said, I'm running for the presidency. Like, listen, control yourself. Don't sleep with no men. Like, he was going to, like it was just that easy for him to be like, okay, sure, it was cheating. But still, Sally, I mean, your husband's gay. So you're going to either have to deal with it now. You think he's not going to sleep with a man. If you win the presidency, you think he's not going to sleep with a man for 8 years? Eight? Sally?
But okay, I'm again. So we're kind of assuming, though, that he hasn't slept with anyone up until now.
Oh, no, I think, oh, he definitely has.
But then, okay, but I think this was her problem. She literally said, you screwed his husband. That is poisonous fruit. So of all people to sleep with, you had a lack of discretion, right? So not only does Cyrus know, number one. Number two, you slept with his husband, and she may not have articulated this during the argument, but there are pictures.
Yeah.
So I think that's a little, like, so again, and I cannot believe I'm saying this, I am not in any way condoning her actions. However, let's really think what happened. Cyrus Bean, of all people, who epitomizes, just like you said, given the fact that she's not only a Bible thumper, but she's a Bible thumper that later on obviously says that her husband is going to hell, despite the fact that she killed him and quote-unquote sent him there. Cyrus symbolizes everything that is wrong with the country, the Republic, and Fitzgerald Grant, right? He is what stands in her way. He has the audacity to come into her office and throw pictures of her husband sleeping with his husband. Imagine the outrage. And I think that's what she was doing, right? So she was literally spewing that outrage like any woman would.
Oh, yeah.
Of their husband having an affair, right? Someone else having to tell you about it who you loathe with pictures. And then your husband has the audacity, the gall, to basically call you out and be like, oh, but you knew. You've always known. Do you know what I mean? You knew and you basically accepted it because you're some rich debutante who couldn't find a husband.
She probably couldn't find a husband, though. Sally ain't that appealing. No, I'm...
But
I know.
But I mean, at the end of the day, though, take your punishment. Like, yeah, take it for a second and basically be like... And he's just like, oh, he's not going to tell anybody. Like, it's no big deal. Like,
well, he's naive. You know, he was naive anyway, though. Like, his whole approach this whole time he's been around has been very... it's been very fraternity boy. Like, very frat house.
It.
Yeah, he's like, what do you mean? He's not going to see anything.
Yeah, and she said, you're my original sin. She goes, because you're pretty and you're stupid and you couldn't take care of yourself. Mm. Do you mean you're my burden? Like she's like, you're pretty and you're stupid. And she goes, I'm taking myself to the promised land. And that's when he said, I'm done.
You do make great points, but you have to look at their relationship, because however long that they've been married, Sally didn't all of a sudden become this way in the sense of where she's always saying things to belittle him and make him feel less of what he is. And so
because I think he was playing his position.
I think I kind of agree with Bamm. You don't start belittling your husband like this week. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You have to ease into it, and that's just not something that you just jump in over time. You got to feel like you got the balls to belittle your man.
Mm-hmm.
And then,
this is gonna make me unpopular. If you think about it, and even she articulates it in calling him pretty and basically stupid, and then basically she goes, the only thing you gave me was our daughter, and she can't even keep her legs closed. They have role reversal, right? No, seriously. So they have role reversal. So she's the VP, and she's the power position, and he's just a pretty face. I think that she may not have belittled him before because he played his position, so she didn't have a need to belittle him. So literally, they had the unity of God on their side, right? So they were that type of a couple where, oh, you know what? Sorry, I'm having a moment. Sorry. Do you remember way back on season one when Sally was running for the president and her then chief of staff, Billy, basically said that they screw all the time?
He said, who screwed?
Remember that Sally and her husband screw all the time.
Oh, that's what
you
said?
Do you gladiators remember this? So remember, basically, because the whole thing was Melly and Fitz don't sleep together, right? And they're cold, and everyone knew they were cold. And Billy says, and I can't remember who Billy says this to, he basically was like, Sally Langston, they don't have that problem. They're like teenagers. Sorry, I had a moment, just popped in my head, I had to get it out. Mm-hmm. But I really think that I don't think that it's part of their relationship. I think maybe once or twice, mm-hmm. but I really don't think. I think it really is the fact that he stepped out of line, and I think that I think she snapped.
Yeah, I think they both stepped out of line, and because their relationship is unbalanced, I don't believe that in the past they've had knockdown fallouts like this.
Oh, I do.
I don't think so. I don't think they've had knockdowns. I think it's more been when Sally's been upset, she's probably said some things to him, and he taking the position that he is, he's just kind of okay. But this time he obviously rose to her level, and I think that's what also made her just go as far as they did. Because look at when Fitz and Melly, when they have arguments and they go back and forth, there's never a moment where either one of them crosses that line.
But that's not a moral issue for them. Mm-hmm. Sally is she's very into her morals. Mm-hmm. Think about how Sally feels about, you know, her husband being gay and just gay people in general. The first time she found out that her husband was gay, like really got the information, Sally seems like the type of woman that will rub that in his face forever. They probably discussed it. She probably cut him down completely. And she's that wife that every day after that, she'll give him a side eye and be like, well, you know how you like it. Like, she's that mm-hmm. type of lady that'll always rub his face in it. So, like, I think they've had knockdown arguments like that before.
But do you think he ever argued back?
That's what I'm saying.
I think so. Because what does he have to lose? He knows when you know that your wife can't get rid of you. But what do you have to lose?
But see, and I think now I'm going to take a different stance. I do agree with you in terms of her sadly belittling Daniel, but I think that before he just took it.
Yeah.
And I think that's why this was different, because the way that he said, I'm done, and not only did he say, I'm done, he basically was like, oh, and I'm going to go do interviews. Like, basically meaning, mm-hmm. oh, I'm about to step out of your shadow.
And I'm going to tell the Sally Langston story. And the way that he did it, his back was turned, and it was, you know, that whole dramatic effect. It was turned around. I'm done.
Yeah.
You know?
Completely. Wait, Bamm, say it one more time.
No.
But no, so I do agree with you. I think she belittles him. But again, I think that because they were playing this role of the role of God, and that in this relationship, she's kind of the preacher or the pastor, and he was just taking it. And I think today he was like, not today.
But think about how ironic it is that Sally feels the way she feels about her husband and his lifestyle, but she caused someone with that exact same lifestyle to have him help her when she needed help. Oh, who, Sally. Oh, really? Oh.
Who else was she going to call? I said this last week.
But then she should have called the police. Like, if at the end of the day, and I know I'm saying exactly different than what I said a couple of minutes ago, if in fact she wanted justice and she felt that she did something wrong and technically the devil walked in, then your savior should be Jesus Christ himself and God. So call the police. And if you're meant to be saved, then you'll be saved, or you'll do your penance in jail.
Or slammer time.
Slammer time. But that shouldn't affect... That shouldn't affect your relationship with God.
But see, Sally's always been that kind of person where she quotes scriptures for her own doing, and she's saved when she wants to be saved. So when I say saved in the term that they use in church, but let's be real. Sally was conflicted. But when the moment when Cyrus told her basically to snap out of it, she got right into it. She fell on top of him and was like,
well, let's back up before that, though. When Cyrus basically is like, no, like, Jesus Christ suffered for your sin so you don't have to. Give me your sin. Like, Cyrus kind of is a little bit of the devil.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Cyrus
devil.
Was, like, quoting, like, the best of them. And he literally was like, okay, because he was doing it for a multitude of reasons. Because at the end of the day, he needs to save his presidency. And he can't have the VP go to jail for murdering her wife. I mean, her husband. Mm-hmm. Freudian slip. I apologize, really. But more importantly, I think that it really showed that, just like you said, that she knows he's the devil. And basically, he got in bed... Yeah, with the devil.
And not only that, but I've always said that Cyrus has been kind of slipping a little bit. He's been kind of slipping. He's been kind of off of his game. And last week when Sally and Cyrus had the conversation in office, you know, Sally totally got him. And people were like, well, why didn't Cyrus, you know, say anything? And I feel like, you know, basically Cyrus is a bully. And when he doesn't have the upper hand, he kind of falls back. But the fact that Sally called him, in the back of his mind, although he's helping her, Cyrus is very, calculated. And so although he was a little conflicted and doing certain things, in the back of Cyrus's mind, he's thinking, hot damn, I got her.
I agree. Also, too, I think that what makes Cyrus an amazing character and what makes the way that the character is portrayed on the screen amazing is that Cyrus is a real human being. So obviously when he enters in and you see kind of flashing back to the pictures and him realizing what he did to possibly lead to this scenario.
He throws up.
I think that what makes Cyrus on some levels so maniacal is that it's not that he doesn't have feelings. I actually think it would be easier if he didn't. He actually legitimately has feelings, mm-hmm. but he's able to literally swallow those feelings for the better, for the good of
the presidency.
The presidency.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
And it's scary.
Yeah. He cleaned that up. That was, he called Quinn and her boo, Charlie, to clean up the office. They stitched up his back, put him in the bed.
But see, right then, I was actually confused. I wasn't sure where they were going to take it. Because I was like, how are they going to run the scenario that he had a heart attack when he, you know, has at least, from the scene, it seemed like at least 4 stab wounds.
Right, yeah. Yeah. I mean.
Which.
And this, that,
and this is why Sally, you know, why she had to do the whole fall on him and leave me alone. That was all what Cyrus wanted to do.
But wasn't there a moment, though, when she was standing there? So when he's basically telling Sally, like, you basically need to snap out of this. And, you know, the doctor walks in and he immediately, Cyrus, go ahead.
Cyrus is he's a cold piece. I love what he did. When he wasn't sure what Sally was going to do, he went right into character. He hugged Sally.
He did.
I mean, come on.
He was like, oh, they're there. It's yeah. Okay.
Who would ever think that Cyrus and Sally would hug? But when the job needs to be done and he needs to put on the act, he hugged Sally.
Yeah, no, he definitely took care of it. Again, Cyrus, like you said, Cyrus is calculated. And I, like... There were some good scenes in this movie. Like, there were some really good scenes when
you
Cyrus...
You said a movie.
The movie. It felt like a movie to me. It felt like a movie. Like, I was watching it like, this is awesome. This is one of the better shot episodes, whatever. Anyway, Cyrus handled this whole situation gracefully. But meanwhile, did y'all think that James was going to go tell David?
Never. Never, ever, 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 ever. So I did think, though, when Cyrus comes home and it's on the news and the way that James reacted, that seemed perfect to me. Because honestly, it's kind of like, dude, you killed Amanda Tanner, and who else did you possibly kill, let alone, James may not know this, but you almost killed your husband. So me thinking you're a murderer isn't really that, you know, far-fetched. But I never thought that the next scene would then be James in David Rosen's office basically saying that he potentially thinks that someone, possibly his husband, killed the vice president's husband.
But even, let's back up before that, why the hell did Cyrus tell Melly?
Yeah, I didn't like that either. Because Cyrus has said before to Olivia, Melly will just basically destroy herself. Like, if you give Melly something to do, she'll bury her own self. Just give her time. So him telling Melly, I get one side of him telling Melly to, because it was he was sitting at the table drunk and Melly was all happy, like, oh my God, isn't this shocking? Maybe he needed somebody to tell at that moment, because again,
he doesn't have Liv right now.
He doesn't have anybody to tell. Who is he going to tell? You know,
and I think
Sally killed her husband.
And I think it's also guilt, like, because basically he was like, no, we're the devil. He's like, she kept saying the devil came in, the devil came in, the devil came in. Ergo, we're the devil.
Yeah.
And then he basically was like, we're done. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? So I think he was. To kind of carry out the religious theme, like, I think he was literally confessing his sins to Melly. And in his world, that kind of makes sense because they're two of a kind.
Well, Melly is an idiot. And the first thing that she does, she goes and she...
Well, she calls Fitz first, which is the good move.
Yeah, she called Fitz and let him know, because Fitz obviously was doing something else. But then when she goes and sees Sally, it's like 2 seconds of, oh, you poor thing. And then boom, she goes right into like, yeah, bitch, I know.
Yeah. Melly, you gotta know when to hold them and when to fold them. That wasn't the time to bring that up. If you got that kind of information, Melly has to bring that out when it really matters and when she really needs it. You didn't need to do that at that moment. Melly didn't need to do that at that moment.
No, she didn't, because they had Sally right where they needed her. And so now that's the Sally's whole disposition changed once Melly let her in on the fact that she knew. So now Melly already can figure, Melly's going to figure out something between Sally and Leo. And so now that Melly knows that, now Sally's like kind of looking a certain way now. And she's
But no, time out, I'm going to cut you off. You forget, Melly already knows what's going on with Leo. She was pretending. Melly already knows that Sally is already trying to run for president.
You're right.
Do you know what I mean? So she was playing them. What she doesn't realize is how Leo literally is like, this is my ticket. I'm not going to let this go. Mm. Do you know what I mean? So I think that's really the problem. And I think that what everyone, or I've always said about Melly, it's twofold. She's a lot more emotional than people give her credit. And it's hubris. She has been walking around for now, what, you know, 3.5 years without anyone thinking that she is someone to be reckoned with, someone who has information, someone that has power. Mm-hmm. So she's basically, she has to at every given moment let someone know that she holds a power position. And ironically, by doing so, she shows that she in fact does not have a power position. Yeah. She can't help herself.
She pissed Sally off. Mm-hmm. Sally, now that whole speech, we're here, just know we took care of it, but no, Melly, pull back. Go have a nice cold drink and regroup later. I didn't appreciate what Melly did.
Quick question for you guys before we move on to the next topic. So do we think that Leo is somehow going to get her out of this mess?
I think Leo is shadier than we think. And I think he's going to be a lot more help to Sally than any of us would have imagined.
Well, the first thing that he says is, if you kill someone, you tell me first. So...
Because what normal person said, like, you know what I mean? Like, if you kill somebody, don't tell me. I don't want to be involved. Well,
from the end of the scene, we see that obviously Shelby, this person who worked for the NSA or some kind of service that obviously was, you know, hacking into people's phones, mm-hmm. has the tape of the conversation between Sally and Cyrus. So, Gladiators, let us know on iTunes whether or not you think that Leo will possibly save the day on the second half of Scandal Season 3. And you can do that by going to iTunes.com. And all you have to do is you click in on the upper right-hand corner, AfterBuzz TV, Scandal, and all of our podcasts come up from Season 1, Season 2, and Season 3. And what you can do is you can rate, comment, and subscribe. So you can literally comment on whether or not you think that Leo is going to save the day, whether or not the VP is going to go down, and whether... if convicted, she's going to take down the entire Grant presidency. So again, go to iTunes.com and rate, comment, subscribe, and always tell a friend. All right, we're going to move on to the second topic. And the second topic is Quinn. So what do you guys think about her trying to go head-to-head or toe-to-toe, mano-a-mano with Mr. Rowan?
I commend Quinn for making the effort. But Quinn, I mean, remember they call her a baby lawyer?
That's exactly what they called her.
Well, now you're a baby spy. So you, I get her ambition, but I wasn't surprised when it didn't go through. Like, I was just like, okay, you know what I mean? Like, okay, it didn't work. All right, next, now what, Quinn?
Bless her heart.
See, where I was actually confused is, part of me, I was sitting there thinking, so I was like, so after you stab Command in the hand with the syringe, how are you going to kill Charlie?
Because he's right behind you.
This is, I don't know if I said this on Twitter or if I've said this, here on our recap. For Quinn to have gone through what she's gone through, and now of all the men... why it is Bamm?
Well, you know, because Quinn has always been in a place since she came with OPA. I remember at first she didn't know herself and her dad shut her down. Remember she tried to go back home and talk to him. He was kind of giving her the side eye. Then she finally felt like, okay, OPA is the only place I have. I'm no longer Lindsay. I'll be Quinn now. I have this new person. I got to find out. Then she got cool with Huck. He was teaching her the ropes. He gave her the side eye. And he kicked her out of OPA. Like, I don't think it's about... excuse me, guys. I don't think it's about him and the person he is. I think it's about he's the only person that's fooling with Quinn. at all. Like, if Urkel would have came in and would have been like, you know what, Quinn, let's do this. She'd have been like, okay. It didn't matter who. Oscar the Grouch could have rolled in there in the trash can. She would have been like, I think he's the one for me. She has nobody else. That's it.
I completely agree, but my problem with Quinn is, obviously, even though we love to make fun of her, and again, like, I think we're all still geeked off of Katie Lowe's calling in last week. I mean, that was just priceless. However, I think that the problem is, even though she's a baby spy, she still has skills,
yeah,
right? And I think that that's part of the reason why Charlie actually does like her, number one. And I think that in his own twisted Charlie way, has some feelings towards her. My problem with Quinn is, you're still a traitor. You didn't bring me anything. So you went into command. You didn't kill Rowan. You didn't get anything. And so when she goes, oh, I came back, well, you got nowhere to go.
And so, where did you go before you came here? Because you took the thing out of your mouth. So, Quinn, where did you go? Like, Quinn, Huck gave her the ultimate boot. She came in and she was like, I'm back. And he said, we do this for Lynn. Liv saved us. I would have killed her. If it wasn't for you, I would have killed you. I would have skinned you. I would have pulled out all of your teeth. And, you know, you're no longer a gladiator.
I'm going to jump back on Team Quinn. I think it's kind of messed up. I think it's cold-blooded. And Liv, again, is so wrapped into her world, which, I mean, I understand what she's going through, but you have not called Quinn. You have not texted her. You have not sent her chicken soup.
Okay, I'm gonna cut you off. I'm gonna cut you off. See, I actually think it's worse than that. I think that she says stuff to Huck like, oh, you tortured her? I can't believe you tortured her. And he's like, yo, dude, she's part of command. Like, I had to know that she's part of B3613. Like, that's major. I feel like Olivia, what's the word? She almost pretends like she cares. Like, she says something enough so that we, as the, you know, as the audience, I know this sounds silly, but we over here think, oh, see, she cares. But she doesn't, because she didn't follow through. She didn't say, okay, no, track her down. Bring her back. This is bad. If she's there, she's in danger. And you never see her check in again.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Bamm.
I couldn't have said it any better. I mean, she does not care. She hasn't called. And it was almost like, you know, she was trying to throw a weight around when she goes into that one tone when she wants to yell at people. And it's just like, for real? Like, what? Huck is riding. He's a ride or die for you and OPA, Liv. So he did what he was supposed to do because she, like, Liv.
And not only that, like, and this is going to sound effed up. He only pulled out two of her teeth.
Yeah.
And, like, when she was like, oh, my God, you put a tracking device on her?
Yes.
Yeah, I put a tracking device on her. Like, are you kidding me?
Yes.
Yeah, if it was Harrison would have, you know, in whatever, in his, as cruel as Harrison can be in his realm, he would have done something harsh to Quinn if he had the opportunity to, especially if it's for the sake of you are betraying Olivia.
And it didn't take until Jake said something to Olivia for her to finally be like, oh, because he said, listen, your dad you may think he's the good guy, but to us, he's still the same old dude. He's still command. He threw Huck in the hole. Huck almost lost his mind. Cut him some slack. Calm down, Olivia. And then she was finally like, oh, maybe you're right. Okay.
Yeah.
Damn.
No, seriously. So do we really think that she goes to OPA, Huck obviously tells her she's not a gladiator, so now she literally is nothing but a member of B3613. Do we think she's still playing Charlie, or do we really believe that she's now there and she's committed to being part of Wonderland?
I think she's going to be there for a while, or at least for... Well, we're at episode 11, 6, 7. She's going to be there, I would say, at least 2, 3, 4 more episodes because she just can't go back so easily back to OPA. Harrison and Abby kind of acknowledged her when she came in. It was like, oh, there she is. And then she walked right in. There was no. So I think it's storyline wise, I think it's great that she's not a part of OPA for the moment because now we get to see where Quinn is going, where she's gonna end up and if she's going to actually come back to OPA. And I'm sure they'll probably come up with some crazy hashtag, you know, yeah. Quinn, come back.
I think if she is, I think the way she left like a sad puppy, I think if they called her back or Huck apologized, she'd come wagging her tail back. I think she'd come back because True Charlie is now this replacement family, this faux boyfriend, but OPA, it's her only family. So it's kind of like if you have a fight with your sister, let's say your sister really said y'all get into it and she's like, don't ever speak to me ever again. But you end up making up. Sure, you don't forget. You don't forget what happened, but you still come back to Thanksgiving dinner next year.
And I still don't trust Charlie 100% that. In my mind, I think he's still playing her just a little bit. And so I don't know if he's going to try and kill Quinn or do something to her. And maybe, I don't know, something is not quite right. I'm not quite sure how she's going to go back to OPA. But I think something's going to hit the fan because Quinn, out of the whole OPA, her storyline is like far, sissy, far, you know, goes past the other OPA members.
I have two opposite theories. One theory is, piggybacking off of what Bamm says, is that I definitely think that she actually could actually fully commit. And the reason being is that we have articulated like a story arc regarding strong women and their skill sets or who they really are not being actualized. Just like I said, for a baby spy, she's a much better baby spy than she was a baby lawyer. And technically, she was a pretty good lawyer. Mm-hmm. Just like if I remember her backstory, like she went to either Stanford or Berkeley, you know, had a top job. That's when, you know, the whole Citron thing happened. And she still, you know what I mean? So at the end of the day, she's still a very, very good attorney. I think she's going to make an even better spy. Mm-hmm. And the difference is Charlie actually lets her kill people. Mm-hmm. The first time she may not have realized, but she still liked it. She didn't like that she didn't know that's what she was going to do, but she was more than willing to kill Rowan. And there was that little spark in her. That's why she was so calm and was able to take out the tracking device in her mouth so much, because she was revved up. Oof. Other theory that I'm still working on is now has changed. Rowan's no longer in charge. Mm-hmm. So if Rowan's in charge, does that mean Charlie still has a job? Because now that Jake is in charge, wouldn't you clean house?
Yeah.
I would. I would definitely clean house immediately in terms of anyone who affected my life and threw me in the hole, which is Charlie and Rowan.
And I would kick Quinn out. If I were Jake, because Jake can be like, mm-hmm. Quinn, you don't belong here. Girl, go somewhere. No.
But Charlie will find a job. He'll be fine. Yeah.
So will he take her with him?
Probably. That's what I'm thinking. He'll take her with her.
I think so, too.
I'm sure Cyrus is going to have to, you know, he's going to have to fix somebody or, you know, fix a death soon.
Because Charlie has Quinn thinking they this whole 03 Bonnie and Clyde, Hov and B. Like, he really has her thinking that they are like this ride or die couple. I think wherever he goes, she'll be right behind him. Like, okay, let's do this.
I was gonna make a Bonnie and Clyde reference. Don't forget, it was Bonnie first, then Clyde.
True.
So Quinn doesn't really fit the bill. She needs to step up a bit. All right, you guys, let's move on to topic number 3, which is the aftermath of Mama Pope. We now know that she is not a housewife or whatever pretend job she had. She's actually a full-blown terrorist, born in East London with Marxist ideologies, and basically seems like she's a terrorist for hire with no true belief system other than possibly money, and it seems like wanting to take down the Republic.
Yeah. She and then she ended up with Rowan, married him, had a family. See, that's the thing that kind of threw me off. Usually, I get you want, you know, you have to have a cover, but to take it that far, that's serious, because now you got a daughter. You know what I mean? Like, I don't.
But then, go ahead.
Think about Huck. Huck was...
But he had the girlfriend before he got into B613.
Yeah, I agree. Totally agree.
Remember, he had her. He came back from the military. He had the girlfriend. And then he had the meeting with B613. And then they brought him in. Olivia's mom, she was a Rolling Stone until, you know,
and not only a Rolling Stone, she literally obviously got together with Rowan because her job was to steal secrets from the CIA, and in essence he's the top of the food chain of the CIA, so obviously she was stealing secrets from Rowan. Mm-hmm. So again, to solidify her cover by not only marrying him but having a child with him, that gives a whole new level of mama dearest or mommy dearest, because again, now to have a child that you claimed to love and care for, again, when she left, why didn't she take Olivia? Because again, and like I said before, what mom would think that their husband, the father of their child, is a monster, and you leave your child? It's one thing to leave your child when we thought she was a housewife with no ends and means, but to know that she's a terrorist, you take your child, or you put her somewhere safe. You don't leave her with the monster of the regime that you're technically trying to take down.
Yeah, I get that. And then you just married him for, did she just marry him for the purpose of her job? Because then take it to the next level. Not only did you leave your child with this monster, you left your child with a man you didn't even like in the first place. So now what? Like this, I'm not surprised that she's bad, but now I'm starting to dip into the personal aspect of it, because you know, if she, you know, she's a cold piece, whatever, okay, but again, that's still your daughter, man. Like, and it's just unfortunate because she knew her daughter. If she was gonna leave, was she ever gonna come back? So either way, if the plane wouldn't have got shot down, or if it was. Was Olivia gonna think she was dead anyway?
I'm gonna disagree. I think Mama Pope leaving her child with Papa Pope was probably the best thing, because she had stability. Although she went to boarding school and some other things, a 12-year-old girl going from country to, like, her life is very, one minute she's on a plane, the next minute she's, and I think that was best for her to leave her daughter with Rowan, where there will be stability.
No, I agree with that part. My aspect of it, though, is, will Mama Pope stop saying that Rowan is this monster and that he's this evil person and saying he turned you into him and you acting like him? Because Mama Pope, really, let's talk about it. Stop saying that, because you know it's not true.
I mean, if she can do all of what she does, do you think that she...
I mean,
she can't just quite come out and just say what she is, because then...
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. There's still something that I'm... I have so many questions that I can't get right. So again, same thing. Why did he leave her in jail for 22 years? Why didn't you just execute her?
Maybe because he loved her.
I was going to say because before she broke out of jail, they had... A interesting husband-wife kind of relationship.
They had a couple
of moments. Even from when he says our daughter has been asking about us. I do believe that they loved each other.
I think he definitely loved her. Mm-hmm. I think he definitely, you know, loved her. I think that's why she was still alive. Because again, Rowan, he can kill anybody. He said in the limo last episode that he said, you know, contrary to belief, I don't enjoy killing people, but he will get it done. Mm-hmm. But I think he loved his wife. And I think that's why he just sat her in there for that long of a time, because it's easier to just lock her away and act like she doesn't exist than to kill the person that you fell in love with and that you have a child. Because even though he kept her away from Olivia, that's still his daughter's mom.
Okay.
So just keep her, you know, just keep her in there. Nobody will know she's here. I don't have to kill her. She's pretty much dead in spirit, but I don't have to kill her, because that's still your wife. That's still his wife. He loved. I think he really loved her.
Okay. Well, speaking of love, Fitzgerald Grant kidnaps Rowan and takes him to an underground cell. Bam, what do you like to...
Bam just crossed his arms in disgust.
This is for me going back to the whole Olivia thing, because, you know, Olivia's thinking about herself, and she demanded for Fitz to take care of this, and she's making all of these orders about certain things, and it's like she's doing too much.
Well, let's actually back up, because so for why me and I was on. I was writing feverishly and I could not get everything. But basically, you know, all of a sudden we see that Rowan is leaving command or leaving Wonderland, and, you know, two cars block him in, and all of a sudden we see somebody in chains, and, you know, he goes, "Where am I?" He sits down, and who sits right in front of him? The President of the United States of America. So basically he's like, you know, "Why am I here?" And he basically, you know, says, "You're going to be here until Maya is safe." That kind of seemed very some like righteous BS. Yeah. I was like, wah, sorry. But what I thought was just, I don't know, like this actually irritated me, is when he started to try to get into his head and he goes, "You know, I'm screwing your daughter." He doesn't say, "You know, I'm in love with your daughter. I'm in a relationship with your daughter. I'm sleeping with your daughter." He said, "I'm screwing your daughter." Technically, I would have actually had more respect for him if he said, "I F-U-C-K-E-D your daughter."
But wait, then he said, "I know what she tastes like." Oh, do ya? Like, come on, Fitz. Like, did we have to take it to that level? That was beyond trying to get under his skin. To me, that was just some... To me, he was talking... He said that to Rowan, like, "Olivia's my side chick." That's what I felt like he was saying.
I completely agree.
He was saying, "She my side chick, so..."
And he basically was like, "She's talented." Like, oh, he did. I mean... Do you know what I'm trying to say? Like, literally, yeah. Like, a part of me was like, okay, Fitz, are you bragging? Are you trying to get underneath his skin? Are you trying to do interrogation 101? Like, I'm a little bit confused here.
I feel like he was partially interrogating him and then trying to get him under his skin so that he can get the information that he wants. But you have to remember, you know, when you watch these shows like Castle and some of the other shows when they do the interrogation, it's one thing when you deal with a local drug dealer or somebody who had robbed a store or something. But this man and his background, do you really think by revealing this information, first of all, Rowan already knew that the two of you already had a little sexual tit-to-tat going on. So did you really think that by you giving this information and being a badass, that he was just going to buckle down and just...
He's a baby interrogator.
No, completely. But yeah. I think that it led up to an amazing scene. Like, like Joe Morton, like, bravo, hats off, I applaud you. Like, you are killing this role. He then goes, "You are a boy. I'm a man. I have worked, fought, scraped for everything that I had." He basically was like, "Poor little rich boy that you've gotten everything in your life. Boo-hoo that you have too much money that you haven't worked for anything. I am a man, you are a boy." So basically he's like, oh yeah, that's what a boy would say. Because a boy would brag about how he's screwing my daughter. And he basically then went on to say, "You only want my daughter because she is mine. She is mine, she is what I created. You like her because she is a door marked exit."
Can we
go ahead?
About the whole created thing, now let's go back to when I said that it was best that Mama left her daughter to be with him, because as we said before, Olivia is just like her dad, nothing like her mom. And he, although he may have taken her to boarding school to do certain things, but when he left her, she learned a lot of things, and she's smart, and she does what she does because she get it from her daddy.
Yeah, she does, but I'm not going to commit to completely saying she's like her dad and nothing like her mom, because we don't know the mom yet.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
She's right now, she's like her dad, but we'll see, because we don't really know mom, and she's skirting around DC. Anyway, keep going.
And I think that, and this is, I'm going to go out on a weird limb. She is, okay. You know, there's a theory that parents basically want for their child what they weren't able to achieve, right? Mm-hmm. That basically each generation improves, right? So Rowan goes into this whole dialogue like, I had to work and scrape to basically get where I've gotten, right? And obviously he's the head of command, and he basically is like, my daughter went to boarding school with kings and children of kings, right? That's a huge step, right? So basically coming from nothing to then not only be like, she didn't just go to like, you know, normal boarding school, she went to like boarding school abroad with the top heads of states, of governments, so forth and so on, right? So I think that in so much as he's living a dual life, he did actually, in fact, create her in his image of what he wants to be, i.e. Rowan, not Eli. Mm-hmm. Now, I think the problem is that there is a part of her who is like Maya, who is the fake facade of a loving mother and slightly seemed like from her backstory, a little bit of a hippie mom, right? That she was more like peace and love and not so much like work, 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 work. And that's partly why Olivia's conflicted. Because if Olivia was actually, oh, now I'm going to go back on what I'm saying. If Olivia was a little bit more one or the other, she wouldn't be conflicted. But now I'm going to switch and say, well, obviously, if Rowan has feelings for the mom, then Rowan has feelings too. So yeah. I think Bamm could be right. Mm-hmm. She's totally like Rowan. Mm-hmm. But keep, go ahead. I was just going to keep going because I thought this monologue was great. So she goes, he basically is like, you like her because she is a door marked exit, that she is your way out. Basically so that you don't have to work anymore. So that you don't have to be your father's son, but you will always be your father's son. You will always be the disappointing son of Senator Grant. And she will always be the formidable Olivia Pope. You are a boy. Sadly, and then he basically is like, you know nothing about me. And he basically leans back. And let's remember, this entire dialogue is going on while he's chained somewhere. And any other normal person would think that they're about to be tortured, killed, something. And he's basically just reading fits. And he basically says, sadly, boy, I know everything about you. And then he goes, and I don't think you're a suitable suitor for my daughter.
Yeah, I think out of everything that he said to him, it started to cut him down when he brought up his dad. But when he said that you're not a suitable suitor for my daughter, I think that's when Fitz was probably, he got a little butt hurt on the inside. I think that right there, because Fitz really does think he is a good suitor for Olivia. He thinks, so what that I have the wife?
Yep.
So what that I, you know, I'm skirting around with, you know, with you and I'm in love with you while I'm married. So what that Melly will see us? Who cares?
So what, who cares?
So what, who cares? I'm a great guy for Olivia. Yay. Here's flowers.
I bought her house.
We're going to make jam. Hey, Mr. Pope, I want to marry your daughter. He really does think that on paper, he looks like the perfect guy.
Now, did you notice, what did you guys think about Fitz's reaction? He seemed unfazed. Do you think he has heard this story so much that he's kind of blanked it out of his head that I'm not really what these people are saying? Or do you think that he was just having a poker face?
I saw a little bit in his eye when he started talking about his daddy. And then when he said the final line about, like I just said, you know, you're not an appropriate suitor for my daughter, he started to change a little bit. When he was talking about you being spoiled and whatever, I really don't think that fazes him. He probably heard that his whole life. You know, after a while, you're like, whatever, who cares? But I saw a little glimmer when he started really hitting below the belt, because I don't care what anybody says. Fitz will forever be butthurt when his dad's name is brought up as comparing it to himself. If you bring up Big Jerry and you compare him to Fitz, Fitz is going to cry in the bathroom. Period.
No, I agree. And I think that opened the wound. And then I think that basically what he was saying is, you will never be good enough for Olivia. And you know this. And it doesn't have to do with the fact that I'm her father. Like, basically, he's like, you're not good enough for Olivia. So I think that in that moment, and basically we've been waiting for it since the beginning of season one, and more importantly, once we found out about Cytron, and basically when we found out the backstory with his father, we've been waiting for Fitz to step up and take accountability for his presidency and accountability for his life. And I think that, again, and this happens on the show a lot, Rowan went one step too far, because he was like, I'm about to show you.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Because at the end of the day, he's like, then I need to be better than you. If you created her, no, seriously, think about it. To take the position, because again, it's weird father issues, really, is what we're dealing with, right? So in order to basically have the full love of Olivia, he basically has to replace her father. And her father is command, which he kept saying to Fitz, it's above your pay grade. You don't have security clearance, and it's above your pay grade. So what is Fitz going to do? Fitz is basically going to take over command, which we see is exactly what he did by putting Jake in, getting Rowan out. And now, theoretically, there's no check. Like, in the three branches of government, and the fact that B3613 was an autonomous being that existed above the Republic, So now he basically controls the democratically elected republic and the non-democratic elected republic.
I still think that there's some information that Fitz and Rowan know about each other, particularly more so Fitz.
I agree.
We're still not getting this because, you know, Liv told Fitz to fix this, to do what you have to do. And Fitz didn't reveal, he didn't give any kind of information. He said he couldn't do anything about it. And now, boom, we go to the mid-season finale. And now Fitz, all of a sudden, has the power, shuts her dad down.
And Jake has, this whole time, has been bringing up subtly that Fitz isn't the guy that Olivia thinks he is.
Yeah.
Like, he knows, there's something that he knows that isn't a part of this whole deal. And he said to her before he left, when he did the whole I love you, I loved you thing and kissed her in the mouth, he said, I wouldn't underestimate the president.
Yeah. Someone on YouTube said that maybe Fitz and Jake are brothers.
I saw that.
I'm not sure about that, but they have a relationship, although Fitz obviously is older than Jake, but they have history.
They definitely have history. Jake knows something that everybody else doesn't know.
Yeah, right. And
okay, wait, are they that much older?
They probably might be like 2-3 years. If they were there in the same time, they can't be that far apart.
Oh, you know what? I'm speaking literally because I know Tony Goldwyn is.
Oh, okay, oh. Yeah. And their characters aren't that much. But go ahead.
Yeah.
Well, Maya shot down. She shot the police. Not the police.
Okay,
the pilots
in the
head.
Can we back up for that?
Yes,
okay,
please.
Back up. Maya. So the minute last episode when Olivia realized that her mom is a terrorist on a plane, what were there? 4 people, 5 people on a plane that basically isn't a passenger plane, is obviously a military plane that Fitz literally got for her. The first phone call you make after calling Huck is you call the president of the United States of America and you go, my mom is a terrorist. So that the president can then call whoever needs to call and you shoot the plane out of the sky. I know, but this is stupid.
No, I agree. You shoot the plane down.
We're going to wait the 12 hours until it gets to Hong Kong. Arrest her the minute she gets off the plane. Off the plane? Why is she getting off the plane?
And Olivia, she chewed her own wrist.
Thank you.
She broke out of the prison hospital and ended up at your doorstep with a trench coat on. Like, she's if she gets off that plane to Hong Kong, you're never gonna see her again. And we see now she was supposedly in Mongolia. But how did she get from Mongolia that quick to back to DC that fast? Okay, anyway.
And I was just getting ready to say, a woman of her expertise, who's to say that the plane was gonna go somewhere? You know, like they're totally underestimating her, and they should have just shut the plane down, period.
And now she knows how to fly a plane. She knows how to fly a plane. It was in Mongolia, and then 3 hours later, it ended up back in D.C. Is she working with a partner? Like, is there a homie that we don't know about? That was fast. Like, come on, really? You can't get back. You know, whatever.
And also, too, why tip off your daughter? No, seriously. So, again, if she has been created in the image of Rowan, which is command, which stands for the Republic, why tip her off?
Maybe she wants to terrorize Olivia. I don't know. She had her Olivia Pope coat and gloves on, though.
But you know what? Do you think maybe that the reason that Rowan didn't kill her is maybe they're closer than what you think? Because now that Mama Pope, the last scene, she had on the coat like her daughter, the gloves, the whole shit.
Got her hair done.
And she has her hair done, and she's right in front of the White House. Now, just think about this. Now, Rowan just lost his job. Fitz just took him down. Now she's at the White House, and now she's going to the White House to cause, you know, some trouble. So, what's their relationship like? Do you think potentially there is something?
Okay. The only reason I'm going to say no, and if they go this way, they go this way. When Olivia came to the Pentagon and the way that she was basically talking to him and like working it out in her head, and basically the minute she realized, wait a minute, Maya played you. You shot the plane down because you thought you were saving people, right? Which, again, from an ethical perspective, that's still a very hard call to make. So even though I'm joking, I'm like, oh, shoot the plane down, whatever. That's not an easy call to make, whether or not it's one life or 1,000 lives. But he made the call because he thought he was saving more lives than would be lost.
Mm-hmm.
And he realized he was played. The fact that he acknowledged Olivia, that Olivia figured it out when she goes, oh, wait, she played you. And she repeated herself. The fact that he nodded and didn't give her the normal Rowan blank, I'm not going to show you any emotion, shows that he was had. There is absolutely no way that a man who basically was command, I don't care who took his job, and whose wife and the mother of his child, who he's kept in prison for 22 years, simply because he loses his job, is now going to side with her. Again, I could totally be wrong.
I think,
but
mine is more of a prediction. I think when Olivia got that plane down, when she ordered that plane for her mom, and she said, "Oh, I got this, and it's gonna be going to Hong Kong, yada yada yada," and she said, "Oh, fancy friends." I think that Olivia's mom, she's been doing this for a long time. She's professional. So when Olivia made those calls, she now knows that Olivia has something that she wants. Or that she would have wanted back in the day when she was, you know, working the terrorist circuit. I think she came back to terrorize the city because now Olivia is a player. And instead of using her dad, Eli, now she can use Olivia. Because Olivia now, she has pieces that...
Brilliant.
She has pieces.
And
pieces to the puzzle.
How does she get... Well, I mean, I guess you can't underestimate her, but how does she get her daughter's number?
Oh, that's really easy. Remember? That's really easy. Because she probably also, from the minute when she was there, like, just went like that. And, you know, I think she's been pretending a lot of stuff. But that's the easy part. Because I think that's Olivia's number. And I don't think Olivia's number is hard to get. Unless it was, like, the bat phone. But I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm. We'll see, man.
Oh, my goodness. So just last impressions of this finale, this winter finale.
I thought it was solid. I liked where it was going. I'm okay with the fact that Mama Pope is still around. I just want to see now, what are you going to be doing, lady? I honestly thought that she was going to come back to D.C. when Roland was walking down the hallway. I thought she was going to put a bullet in his back.
I thought
it was lights out for Roland. But I want to see if she's going to work this whole payback for him thing. Like, is this payback for Roland time? Is she gonna terrorize him? I'm happy with the way it ended up. I'm cool with it.
I'm majority happy. I'm still just bothered that the OPA are taking back seats to all of these other great storylines that's intertwined with everything. I'm just really bummed that OPA does not really have a storyline, and Quinn is the only one who's now, she was OPA, now she's not. It just kind of bothers me that that Harrison and Abby doesn't have a storyline. David has more oomph and fun than Harrison and Abby. So that bothers me.
Yeah. Abby had one, though. Remember when David was doing his whole spy wall and he had the stuff and Abby was trying to jump on his bandwagon? Abby had something for a minute, but it kind of fizzled away.
But the only moment that Abby had was when the girl came in, she kind of gave her that, like, you know, stop looking at my man look. I need more. That's my only issue.
Yeah.
But still good.
What'd you think, Sophia?
If I could have switched the energy of part one and part two, for me, that would have been better.
Mm-hmm.
Part one, I thought, was arguably the best episode of the season.
Yeah.
Definitely top five episodes of Scandal, season one, season two, season three. The energy was electric. It had that Scandal pace. For me, I thought, just like you said, Kennelia, the way that the episode was shot was really great, but there was a part of the energy that for me was a little, I don't know if it was staccato on purpose, but it just didn't gel for me. There were segments that were amazing, but somehow the whole thing didn't gel for me. Like, no, I wish it.
Totally agree. And then the last segment where everything kind of all tied in together, you know. Now you got James now on the other side. Now he got the power, and then there's something. Yeah.
So I think officially the devil has come in. So we'll see what happens with that. So that is it for right now for the winter finale, and we're gonna go into news and gossip before we wrap everything up.
AfterBuzz TV News.
Oh well, it was announced yesterday the SAG Award nominations as well as the Golden Globe nominations, and Kerry Washington is nominated for Best Actress for a drama series.
Yay!
for Scandal, and you know, congratulations to Kerry. I'm still a little with. There's a lot of great performances with Scandal, and I understand, you know, Kerry's a breakout star, and she kind of carries it, but there are some other characters that
Jeff
are
Perry,
really...
Jeff Perry, Bellamy Young, yes. Guillermo Diaz. I mean, that's just my top three.
Yeah,
I mean, totally. Jeff Perry should... easily be nominated.
Melly
Young, I think Melly, without a doubt.
Yeah.
Melly, I could see why she's not nominated, but Jeff.
Oh, and I cannot.
Jeff Perry. I'm just based off of who the competitors are in the category who's nominated. Jeff Perry deserves, I feel he deserves a nomination. And I think Joe Morton, if he keeps it up, he will be nominated for guest actor. But I just wish there was more, or why wasn't Scandal nominated for an ensemble, especially with the popularity and with it being SAG. I don't understand why it wasn't nominated, but you know.
I think it, because it's so new, because then you had to nominate Breaking Bad. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
like there are certain ones that had House of Cards. You had to not, you know. I don't know. I think it's coming. Hopefully it better be coming, but we'll see, man. It's still early. It's still early,
but I feel like right now Scandal is at its peak right now, and I feel like this is a time where they should hands down be nominated. I mean, House of Cards has only had one season. Scandal's at its peak right now, and I feel
Scandal. And I think this is also weird. All the shows that we mentioned, none of them are network.
That's true.
Think about that. And a lot of people have said that. And again, I think that ABC and Shonda Rhimes, that you guys do an absolutely amazing job, but there are still parameters that you have to exist in, which those others get to go literally off the wall. I don't know. I think that could have something to do with it. But also, too, you know, we have been, the season three has been reduced from 22 episodes to 18. So that also means that we here at AfterBuzz are being reduced from 22 to 18. But we will definitely be back February 27th. But again, if you guys do not know, Scandal season three will actually be 18 episodes. Yeah. But jump on Twitter. Make sure that, I don't care if she doesn't win. I actually think she's going to win. I think it would be amazing if she swept. That could maybe lead the way for something in terms of an ensemble cast. But I definitely think that you watching the show, just like Katie Lowe said last week, is actually the best award, because numbers speak for themselves. And the Scandal Gladiator universe, I think that you can't buy that. You can't put that on TV.
Yeah. Well.
All right. Well, now let's go directly to predictions.
And now, you're AfterBuzz TV predictions.
I am going to start off, and I'm going to reiterate the prediction that I made last week, that I think that basically Maya and whoever she is and Fitz's involvement is going to be the new presidential scandal for the second half of the season.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I think it's because, personally, I think not only because Fitz chartered a plane for this terrorist, but Olivia basically said to her mother, my friend, Whisper, the president, can do all of this stuff, pull all of these strings. He's here to help us. To Maya, that's like, ding, ding, ding. Oh, ooh, ooh. Well, we got a new target now. So let me capitalize on this whole Fitz situation. So I agree with that. I think that's where it's going to go. I think Sally is still going to be trying to run for this VP, this president spot, especially with Leo now being this super duper bad guy. If he doesn't care about getting his hands dirty, guess what? We're back in business, and Cyrus can't really shut her down because you're involved in the scandal too. On a side note, my cold piece, because I always forget, cold piece of the week, guys. It's a trifecta. Sally, Cyrus, and Mama Pope get the threesome with cold piece of the week, all three of them.
I think that Melly is going to try to stop this whole Sally thing from running for president. And I believe Leo is going to come into play because, I mean, it's no secret, so this is not a spoiler alert. But, you know, allegedly Melly has a new man that's coming into the picture sometime. And so Leo probably may have something to do with Melly's background. Did or did she not sleep with this guy from back in the day? I think Leo has, you know, Melly said Leo's a bad guy. So they have some kind of, I feel something coming from Leo and Melly and Sally and, of course, Cyrus. I do like the fact that James kind of has the upper hand with Cyrus, but for how long and when will Cyrus take the power back?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I think all good.
Maybe Leo planted Melly's new boo. Like they planted James for Daniel.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Oh, my God. I can't even think that Melly would do that. Oh my God, that is the show, Gladiators. We will be back February 27th. Tell everyone where they can find you guys.
You can find me on Instagram and Twitter at Bamm Ericsen, and you can also go to BigSixEntertainment.com.
You can find me on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at Kennelia. And Kennelia.com just launched, so check it out for all things Kennelia.
And you can find Emil on all social media at Emil Ennis Jr. He will be back when we're back on February 27th. And I am Sofia Stanley. You can find me on Twitter at Sofia Stanley. Bye, Gladiators. Happy holidays.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here. And be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.